Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the IAS Commons. We are going to host a series of talks in which we are going to invite speakers to tell us about something new and exciting in layman terms, so that faculty and staff and students who may not be exactly in the same field or the same area can also understand some new and exciting developments. Today, we are very happy and honored to have us, Gunther Uhlmann, to tell us something about inverse problems and how to solve that and achieve this science fiction type Harry Potter's invisibility cloak. Professor Uhlmann is one of us, he's an IAS CUN professor, and in fact, I have in my cell phone, you know, whole page of his honors, and I don't think I should read all of this information to you, and if you want to know about Professor Uhlmann's achievement, feel free to go to the IAS website and take a look. And I just want to mention that Professor Uhlmann is the has been awarded the Bolger Prize and also the Kleinman Prize, both our top prizes in applied mathematics. Some of us know that in the field of inverse scattering problem, Professor Uhlmann is one of these world leading scientists. Without further ado, I will let Professor Uhlmann tell us how to achieve the Harry Potter's cloak.
Thank you very much for the very nice introduction. It's a great pleasure for me to be here in IAS and Hong Kong. I have an office with an absolutely gorgeous view of the bay. And very rare to be able for me to be in the same place as any top people are. Nobel Prizes, Wolf Winner Prizes, and so on and so forth. Okay, so let me introduce you to the inverse problems first. It's very hard to define what an inverse problem is. Anytime you try to define it, you will find a counterexample. So direct problems are the ones where you know a medium, then waves, different type of waves, electromagnetic waves, sound waves, elastic waves, and so on. And then, because you know the medium, you can infer the response. So you can say what is going to happen later, for instance, if there is time involved. But in many problems in science and technology, we don't actually know the medium, the parameters of the medium. So you probe the medium with waves, different type of waves again, and you measure the response as much as you can from the response. Usually, you cannot measure everything. And from that, you try to infer the properties of the parameters here, what produce those measurements. These type of problems in inverse problems are called active measurements, because you are probing medium with waves. Well, I'm going to give some examples of passive measurements later on. We solve the inverse problems all the time. We're solving it right now. In this case, vision, the field, the waves are is light, which are electromagnetic waves. And then we measure the reflection of the light on the different objects in our eye, in our retina. And from that, our brain builds a three-dimensional, really amazing map of the scene. And this occupies a large part of our brain. And neuroscience, you want to understand how does the brain does this, solves this inverse problem. And actually, there is some information, but still it's not completely understood. The different type of waves is the case of what dolphins do. Water propagates, sound propagates at a high speed in water, four times the speed of sound in air. And it's very dark here. You cannot use electromagnetic waves under the sea. So dolphins, for instance, send sound waves. And from the echo, they built an image. Again, the question is, how do they do that? And can we build equipment to do the same? And in fact, that has been done. Sonar, to a large extent, does this, send waves and measure the response. So high-frequency waves, this is than the ones that the dolphin uses, are used by bats to find their way. So send very high-frequency waves, and again, from the echo, makes an image, finds the prey, and so on. Ultrasound, in medical imaging, I'm going to show this later, uses the same principle. Send very high-frequency waves, and from that, from the echo produced, we built an image. And this is, so equipment has been developed to do this, is sonar. And you send, again, explosions of sound waves, and you measure the response. And this can be quite complicated. There can be different types of medium here, and so it's not so easy to solve this inverse problem. And it took a long time to actually find the Titanic. It was more or less known where it has sunk, but only rather recently was this image was found of where exactly it was and the shape that it was. But using the same principle that dolphins, bats use, send, in this case, explosions of sound waves and measure the response. So there are many different kinds of waves that you can send. You can, and this list is not exhaustive by any means. You can send acoustic waves, as the ones I have mentioned, electrical waves, magnetic, radio waves, microwaves, then the optical waves, X-rays, which are high frequency, so the frequency is increasing, gamma rays and particles and so on. And the different waves recover different parameters. You're trying to find different things in the medium. And so the waves are sensitive to certain parameters. There are different systems. I'm not going to talk about all the systems that are available. There are lots of them. And I'm going to concentrate on the ones where I have done some work. The seismic imaging is one, ultrasound. Electrical impedance tomography is another one that we'll describe in a little bit more detail. Also, we have optical imaging, computed tomography, CT scans, and so on and so forth. Again, there are many different kinds of systems and probes. Seismic imaging, a very important economic inverse problem, that you're trying to find oil in the subsurface of the Earth. Most of the oil exploration is done in the ocean. So you have a ship here that has a long tail. You send sound waves, guns, and in the same tail, you have hydrophones that measure the response. Sound guns here. Then you try to find this complicated structure behind in the surface of the sea, in the subsurface of the sea. So here is the oil. The oil is usually hidden behind salt dams that have a very low sound speed. So it's they're very much hidden. That's why this is a difficult inverse problem. But from the reflections of the waves, you try to infer this structure. So this is a cartoon explaining what is done. So these are guns of sound. You send explosions of sound. You measure the response in this tail. And from that, you try to infer. So the ship moves usually in parallel lines. And this, again, the same principle is for electromagnetic waves led to the development of radar that is used every day. You send electromagnetic waves, and again, from the echo of the electromagnetic waves, to infer the properties of the object, where it's located and so on. So another inverse problem is in global seismology. We have not been able to realize Julius Verne's dream of going to the center of the Earth. The biggest hole that has been drilled is about 60 meters far from the radius of the Earth. So one of the ways that we have to get this information about the center is from earthquakes. Earthquakes are very strong, very different frequency than sound waves, penetrate deeply into the Earth. And what you measure is the travel time between different seismic stations around the Earth. There are many seismic stations. And this is an example of the Magnolia earthquake, which was 7.1 in the Richter scale, was in 1990. I come from Chile, in spite of my German name, and Chile has produced a lot of data for geophysicists. There are earthquakes all the time in Chile. In fact, the largest earthquake ever recorded was in 1960 in the south of Chile that completely wiped out the south, changed the geography, was 9.5 in the Richter scale. So these are, we call it passive measurements. You're not sending waves. The waves are generated inside by some mechanism. And from the information that the earthquakes give, you try to infer what's happening. I'm giving a mini course on inverse problems, different kinds of inverse problems in, here, and I'm going to talk about this problem, the travel time problem, from the travel times, how you recover the inner structure of the Earth. I couldn't find a picture of the 1960 earthquake, but there was a picture of the tsunami. So this is Chile, it's a very long country. The earthquake was in the south of Chile, in Valdivia, near Valdivia. The largest tsunami that has ever been seen, it came from there and it went through the Pacific. But the Pacific, it provoked havoc in many countries, in the Pacific, for instance, Japan. Another source of inverse problems is medical imaging. A lot of cases in medical imaging, you try to see what is inside without penetrating the object. You don't want to be operating persons all the time. And a prime example was the development of CT scans through X-ray tomography. So this is a section, two-dimensional section of the human body. You send a source of X-rays and you have a detector here. X-rays travel approximately in straight lines. They are very high-frequency electromagnetic waves. And you move the source around and the detector around. And the problem is, can we recover the density of the different tissues from how much the X-rays are attenuated? The propagation here is along straight lines, dependent on the tissue. The rays are attenuated differently depending on the tissue. You measure that attenuation, the difference in attenuation, and from that you try to infer the density of the attenuation of the different medium. In mathematical terms, this is reduced to the problem of the following problem. You have a function, which is the density, and what you can determine from the attenuation of the X-rays is the integral of the function along lines. So Radon considered this mathematical problem in 1917, motivated by completely theoretical issues. He was not thinking about X-ray tomography. The question is, can you determine function from this integral along lines? And he solved this problem in 1917. And this was not applied until much later in the 1960s when Cormack and Hounsfield developed the first tomographs. This is one of the examples where pure was called pure mathematicians, and I really don't like this word. and applied mathematicians were not talking to each other. There was this formula available for a long time. And Cormack, his physicist, rediscovered this formula. He did not use the formula of radon. He just rediscovered it. And he and Hounsfield developed the first tomograph, and for that received the Nobel Prize in Medicine. So this completely revolutionized medicine. And now you get very good detailed images of the inside of the body by using CT scans. So you put X-ray, you take a two-dimensional section and send X-rays different directions. And in fact, the method that's used in most CT scans is based on the formula found by radon. The discrete example of this is the following. It's a form of Sudoku. You have here different numbers that corresponds to the different density of tissues. Binary number, here I put the 3 by 3 squared, so 9 numbers. Here is the X-ray source, and here is the detector. What you are determining is the sum. For instance, in this case, 4 plus 5 is hopefully 13. And then you take different lines, different X-rays, and from that information, you try to infer these numbers. So this is the problem we're trying to solve, except that this is the discrete analog. But in practice, we never have all the lines. Also, it's too much radiation. Radiation is damaging to tissue, so you want to take as few rays as possible, called full angle in inverse problems. So you have, in this case, 9 unknowns and 11 equations, so it's overdetermined. In most problems, inverse problems, you have an underdetermined problem. You have 9 unknowns and few measurements, like in this case, you have 4. 8. I cannot read the number. 8 linear equations. It's underdetermined, so there is no uniqueness. You cannot do it completely, but the question is, what can you determine? Another very powerful medical imaging technique is magnetic resonance imaging. Instead of sending X-rays, you use a very strong, you subject the tissue to very strong magnetic field to produce images, and this is based on the water content of the different tissues. That changes with the tissue. Also, the body is water, and from that response, you create images like this. This is me. Hope you can see it in the computer. It's much clearer. It's a very detailed picture of the bone structure of the very powerful method, and also received the Nobel Prize in 2003 for the development. So the same principle, as I mentioned, that bats use of sending high-frequency waves is used in ultrasound all the time. In pregnant women, you send sound waves, high-frequency sound waves, you measure the echo, and from that information, you create an... Okay, so a completely different type of probes is electrical impedance tomography. In the mathematical literature, it's called Calderon's problem. For the people here who are not mathematics, Calderon was a very famous analyst, one of the top analysts of the 20th century in Argentina. And here, what you're trying to recover is not density or attenuation, like in the case of X-rays, or not the water content, like in the case of magnetic resonance imaging, but the conductivity. So this is a different function. It measures how much electricity is being conducted from one place to the other. The conductivity is 1 over the resistivity. Resistivity is the resistance of the material to current. And the question that Calderon proposed is, can you recover this conductivity inside the body by making voltage and current measurements just on the outside? And his motivation, this was in the 40s, was geophysical prospection. I want to give you a cartoon of this, trying to find oil. Again, because the conductivity of oil is very different than the conductivity of the surrounding tissue, surrounding medium. And here is a picture, I'm going to show this again later, of the currents, very different than X-rays. The currents go immediately everywhere. A very diffuse type of inverse problem. And this is the type of images that you can create. It has also been proposed, this is geophysics. I mentioned that geophysics is one of the important applications of inverse problems. And the medical image is another one. This has also been proposed as a method for early breast cancer detection because normal breast tissue has a very different conductivity than the cancerous breast tumor. And the reason is that cancerous tumors need blood to grow, and blood is very highly conducting. This is information that is very hard to pick up with X-rays. Calderon said something interesting when he accepted the doctor honoris causa from Universidad Autónoma de Madrid. He said it in Spanish. He worked for the oil company in Argentina in the 40s. At that time, there was no degree in mathematics in South America, in Argentina in particular, not in Chile where I was from. So he was an engineer, and a summer he worked for the oil company of Argentina, Yacimientos Petrolíferos Fiscales. He said, my work there, YPF, was very interesting, but I was not well treated. Otherwise, I would have stayed there. I was very fortunate for mathematics that Calderón was not well treated in YPF. Otherwise, we would have missed many of his wonderful contributions. So some fishes, called electrical fishes, use electrical fields to find their way around. I mentioned before sound. This is one. Here, some food is going to be thrown, then he will pick it up using electrical fields and grab it. This is a more detailed picture of what he does. So he makes a detailed picture of the electrical field around, and from that you can get the prey, so make an image in some way. This has been studied quite a lot, how these fishes do this. It's a very interesting phenomenon. There are many important articles about this. And look, go to this web page that has a lot of information about that. A discrete model for this is the following. You have a network, and here in this case I drew it rectangular, but can have other shapes, resistors. Remember, the resistance is the inverse of the conductivity, and you have nodes outside, and you put voltages here on the nodes outside this resistor network, and you measure the induced current flux at the nodes. And from that information, you try to infer the resistors here. This is, you can generalize this to a graph. Have many complicated situations. Actually, in the internet, the connections in the internet, you have internet tomography, is very similar to this. So this is the geophysical application that Calderon had in mind, electrical impedance tomography. And here you put electrodes to make a log well. This is still being done to find oil. You put electrodes here. You input a voltage and you measure the induced current flux. And here you have also a case of partial data, but you don't have data everywhere. You don't have data here, for instance. And from that, you try to infer this, whether there is oil or not, again, because the conductivity here is very different than the surrounding medium. And for breast cancer, in medical imaging, the setup that is done, you put electrodes on one side, and there is a tumor here, and you compress the breast, and then the reason to consider this method rather than mammography, which is the standard method recommended for screening nowadays, is that is the problem is that the X-ray attenuation is almost the same in cancerous and healthy tissue. Especially in young women, this tissue is very soft. The density doesn't vary much even for you have cancer, but however, the conductivity is very different. So David Isaacson and his group have been trying to use this to for screening, to combine it with mammography for screening in breast cancer. Mammography, unfortunately, misses a lot of cancers. So this is a picture of what the currents do. This is a very difficult inverse problem because the currents go all over the place. You put an electrode in the body, the currents go all over the place. It's not like X-rays traveling in straight lines. So these are called diffuse inverse problems, and to recover from that, the boundary information is quite difficult. This is a system that is actually used in hospitals. This is David Isaacson. These are the electrodes. You can see it's very safe. This is one of the advantages of electrical impedance tomography. Very safe. Put a small voltages here. And you input voltages, and you measure the current flux. And from that, in this particular case, what they were trying to do is image the blood as it leaves the heart and fills the lungs. Because, again, blood is very highly conducting, so the contrast is very high. You can image that. You can monitor this in hospitals, whether a lung, for instance, has collapsed continuously at the bedside. You can put this equipment. It's not very complicated. It's very cheap, safe. However, the problem with the method is that the images that you get they don't have very high resolution. Because, again, it's a very diffuse inverse problem. The currents go all over the place. But, however, you get that contrast, that information. So this is an image that you can do from the blood going in and out of the lungs and the heart. In the previous example, there is a wave coming in, and then you measure the information produced. I'm given a mini course on this photoacoustic tomography here. And it's a very different principle. You send electromagnetic waves, so a laser pulse, very rapidly varying laser pulse. This is absorbed by the body, produces a thermal expansion. And because there is a thermal expansion, the tissue is expanding or contracting, it produces an acoustic wave. And what you measure is the acoustic wave on the boundary. So you send an electromagnetic wave, and you measure an acoustic wave. And from that, you try to infer the optical properties of this poor rat here. Try to make an image. So from one wave, you produce another wave. So it's like lightning, light coming in, and thunder, the explosion. The explosion is what you're measuring. And the reason to use both methods because the two different types of waves give you different information about the medium. It can be combined to get a better resolution. For instance, Li Hong Wang and his laboratory in Washington University, using these methods, has found very detailed and very high resolution image of the vessels near the skin here, and you can see the melanoma. So this is one of the perhaps methods that you will see in the next 10 years or so in hospital. The main problem is that you cannot penetrate very deeply. So these are very nice pictures near the skin, but there has been a lot of work in trying to get deeper and deeper into the body. So different astronomy and astrophysics is another source of inverse problems. Most of the information that we get about the universe is indirect. We cannot prove it. Let me mention that one of the first scientific inverse problems that was solved was by Newton. So he knew Kepler's laws. One of Kepler's laws is that the planets go around the sun in ellipses. And he thought about the gravitational force as his big insight. The question was, what force produces these orbits? And he invented calculus, force equal to mass times acceleration. So he knew the trajectories. And from the trajectories, he tried to find the force that will produce that. And he realized that the only explanation for this elliptical orbit was the inverse square law. In other words, the force is inverse proportional to the square of the distance between two objects. He invented calculus to solve that inverse problem. You know some solution of the differential equation, and from that you try to infer the force. Okay. But of course, in astrophysics, what you observe is what's coming from light observations. This comes from billions, sometimes billions of years ago. And we hope that gravitational waves can also give information, but of course, it has not been found. One of the interesting phenomena here, why it's a difficult problem, is because of what's called gravitational lensing. You have a very strong force here, a very large mass. General relativity tells you that the rays of light will be deflected, that will come to this point later on, and forms a lens, and you can get multiple images of the same star. This is called Einstein's cross. That is produced because of gravitational lensing. You have four images of the same star. So the inverse problem here is the following. Can you determine the structure of space-time? And you would like to recover that, what has happened before, when we see light coming from many point sources. Nowadays, we have more and more observations. The question is, can you find out what actually happened? And at least theoretically, this is possible, and I want to talk about this in more detail in my last lecture in the mini course. Okay, so we come here to the opposite problem. Inverse problems, you try to find what is inside by making measurements outside. In cloaking, you want to make objects invisible. It's the opposite. You want to make it so that you don't find it. You find a medium so that you don't find what is inside. So there are two sides of the same coin. This is what I want to point out. So this has been a subject of interest to humans for millennia. Invisibility, how to make objects invisible. And there has been a lot of progress on this in recent years. Let me show some clips on science fiction that are relevant to the science of invisibility of these works. Okay, invisibility is coming. Oops, sorry. I don't want to show this again. Okay, the invisible man, that was the first clip from the movie, makes himself invisible by making his index of refraction, determines how much is being reflected, refracted, and so on, the same as of air. So that's why you see here completely, this part completely invisible, the rays of light go straight through. You see the clothes, because those have not changed the index of refraction. This reflect, and that's what you see with your eyes, as I mentioned before. So this chemical procedure is highly non-recommended, dangerous, and unlikely to work. The human body is very heterogeneous. Actually, the invisible man tried to reverse this process himself. The invisible woman, but the idea of changing the index of refraction is a good one. The invisible woman makes herself invisible, this is from the Fabulous Four, by deflecting light around her. So by using somehow mental powers, or I don't know exactly what, he can deflect light around her so she becomes invisible. A more perhaps scientific way of doing this, of deflecting light, is in Star Trek, in the make invisible the ship here. You put gravitons, and this is an analogy with relativity that will come in several points of my lecture. With gravitons, of course, we cannot really build this practice, because gravitons, they have a strong gravitational field. And as I mentioned before, the gravitational field will deflect light. So they will turn on the gravitons, and then the rays of light will be deflected around, and the ship will become invisible. You can turn it on and off, invisible and not invisible, and so on. So this idea of deflecting light plus changing the index of refraction, this is realized through a cloak, a Harry Potter's cloak. So you build a cloak, it's an index of refraction such that the rays of light will go around, and so what is inside becomes invisible. We're going to build a cloak. The point of this lecture is to tell you a blueprint for building a Harry Potter's cloak. So we know exactly what the materials have to be to have a perfect cloaking. Of course, I should make a demonstration. This is myself half cloak. Another one, my hand invisible. There have been several proposals, scientific proposals for invisibility. Transformation optics has attracted a lot of attention because it's very simple and also very general. It can be applied to many other things besides cloaking. So there was two articles in Science in 2006 that received a lot of attention by Pendry et al. And by Leonhardt. The paper by Leonhardt is in two dimensions, called optical conformal mapping. And the paper of Pendry et al. Was in three dimensions. And this was more for the rays of light, and these are the waves, Maxwell equations. There was an earlier article of Greenleaf, Lassas, and myself, where we actually found non-uniqueness for the Calderon's problem that I described before. And we use exactly the same transformation that Pendry et al. Use. And this transformation is the one that's used for anything you want to make invisible in transformation optics. And Science Magazine has a very good description of transformation optics that I'm going to try to explain in more detail. The real breakthrough may lie in the theoretical tools used to make the cloak in such transformation optics. Researchers imagine a la Einstein warping empty space to bend the path of electromagnetic waves. So you want to make the light go around. You want to warp space. Mathematical transformation then tells them how to mimic the bending by filling unwarped space with the material. Optical properties vary from point to point. So we want to change the index of refraction. Any way you look at it, the ideas behind invisibility are likely to cast a long shadow. Of course, we don't want shadow. Invisibility means no reflection, no refraction. You can do it from any possible direction. You have invisibility, not just partial invisibility. So this is from the paper of Penry et al. This is a cartoon. Here are the rays of light. Here is Harry Potter in this ball, orange ball. And the blue part is the cloak. So this is, of course, a two-dimensional cross-section. So the rays of light will go around. And when you measure it outside the cloak, it seems that everything, the rays went straight through. Looks exactly the same as they came in, very much like in the case of the invisible man. So whatever is in here is invisible. We have changed this cloak, has an index of refraction such that we can do what the invisible woman or Star Trek were trying to do. And what we did in the paper I mentioned in 2003 was for the case of electrostatics, for currents. Remember, the problem is to recover the conductivity inside by making measurements outside. We show that that's not possible for some conductivity. So on the left, the picture of the currents for an homogeneous medium, conductivity one, say, or constant, and the currents go straight through. So we built the conductivity, this is the cloak here, in such a way that the currents go around. When you measure it outside, this annulus looks exactly the same as the picture on the left. So you cannot distinguish between the picture on the right and the picture on the left by making measurements outside. Whatever you put inside here, inside this ball, is completely invisible to the measurements. Okay, so this is non-uniqueness in mathematical terms, because these two conductivities give you exactly the same measurements. Okay, so what we want to do is to deflect light. So I want to explain now how do we do this, how we construct these conductivities or electromagnetic parameters. Again, the analogy is with relativity. I mentioned this already. You have a very large mass. Light will be deflected. Space will be warped in such a way that light will be deflected, and what you're seeing is in a different position than really is. Of course, we don't have a strong gravitational field, but we have something very important, which is in the zero relativity, which is symmetric. And in our case, we'll have the index of refraction. So the opposite of what we're trying to do is, in some sense, a black hole. This is another striking effect in relativity. All the rays of light will be trapped if you go beyond this area. And then you are not going to be able to see anything. That's why it's called black hole. So in some sense, we're trying to build an optical, this is for light, white hole. So the rays of light will go around, and this will become invisible. And instead of trapping the rays, we want to deflect them in such a way that it looks like nothing happened. The rays went straight through when you make the observations outside. So the index of refraction is what determines the propagation of rays. You have air and water, so this is going to play the analog in general relativity of a metric. For the people who know about this, you have air and water, then the rays of light will break. You want to follow Fermat's principle, trying to go in the minimum amount, light tries to go in the minimum amount of time possible between one point or the other. So this is an example where you see the fish in a different position that actually is an optical illusion. Invisibility is a form of optical illusion. Now, a striking example of that, where this is done, the rays of light are continuous, is a mirage in the desert. Very hot, and the index of refraction varies in such a way that the rays of light, to go from one point to the other in the minimum amount of time possible, deflect. When you think you're seeing water, you're actually seeing the sky. I'm sure that in Hong Kong, it's very hot in the summer, and in the road, you will see water when you are in the car. This is, of course, an illusion. Okay, let me see. I don't have much time, so let me explain now the idea of transformation optics. So these are the rays in the left, is that the rays of light form a Cartesian coordinate system. And this is going to be physical space. So the blue ship, the blue fish, is what we're trying to make invisible inside this ball. So what we want to do is warp space in such a way that the rays of light will go around here. And this will become invisible. So what we do, we just take this point, we make the following transformation. This is what's called, why it's called transformation optics. We transform by blowing it up, by making it larger and larger, this point to this ball. We send this point to this ball here by the transformation, and the laws of physics are invariant in the transformations. So whatever is in here corresponds to a point in virtual space. But a point, you cannot see it. It's invisible. You can't see a point. So since there is this one-to-one correspondence between virtual space and physical space, like this transformation, one can write down the transformation. Whatever is in here corresponds to a point and therefore is invisible. What you build here, what you have here, whatever it is, Harry Potter or the blue fish or whatever, is invisible. That's the idea of transformation optics. It's based on the fact that the equations are invariant of the transformations and that you cannot see a point. In three dimensions, you cannot see a line either, or a curve. This leads to other applications. But of course, we want to do this for the waves as well, not just for the rays. One of the camps of civilization has been Maxwell equations. This is E and H electromagnetic field, the realization that light is an electromagnetic wave. Of course, this was a summary of a lot of work done previously, Faraday and other people. K here is the frequency. Epsilon and mu are the electromagnetic parameters. Is the electric displacement, B the magnetic displacement. So you have these Maxwell equations written in vectorial form. This is one of the few equations I'm going to write because it deserves to be written. Somebody said that the basic research that Maxwell and others were doing at the time will pay for all the basic research for the next 500 years. The applications of this are enormous. Most of the scientific technological developments, the 20th century, computers, cell phones, etc., television, radio, etc., are based on these equations, amazing equations. And the index of refraction, so the connection with the ray theory of light is that the index of refraction is the square root of epsilon times mu. And so now it's understood that the ray theory of light is an approximation to the wave theory of light described by equations for high frequencies, for large k. And from that, I can tell you what the electromagnetic parameters are going to be. I have electromagnetic parameter 1 here, which is vacuum or air is approximately 1. And then I take that electromagnetic parameter with this transformation, I push it forward to here, and I get new electromagnetic parameters by this transformation that sends this point to this ball. And I know exactly what the electromagnetic parameter will have to be, just by this transform, the push forward by this transformation, you send these parameters here to parameters there. So I can write them down. This is one of the few equations I'm going to write, and here is electric permittivity and the magnetic permeability. This determines the electrical properties and the magnetic properties. And in spherical coordinates, you can write them down here. R2 is the radius of the ball where Harry Potter is. R1 is the other one, the outside ball. And I have an formula that tells me what electromagnetic parameters are here and therefore the index of refraction. And the same procedure is for the conductivity that I showed you before. You take conductivity 1, you push it forward by that transformation, and you get a new conductivity here that goes around like the rays do here. We have a blueprint for invisibility, for first clocking. The problem is, and this is based on, this is a simulation done based on our work. You send waves here. We're sending them in this direction, but you can do this in any direction. This is the object that you want to make invisible, goes around, and when you look at the other side, it looks exactly like the plane wave that you have. So the question is whether we can realize or not this. This is the theory behind invisibility. Can we actually do it or not? This is an important subject, relatively new, called metamaterials, beyond materials. But the idea is to construct the materials that you cannot find in nature. And this is one of them. Of course, it will be invisible. The epsilon and the mu here, you cannot find them in nature. It will be invisible anyway. Most materials actually have mu, the magnetic permeability, to be 1. So this is quite difficult to do, epsilon equal to mu and equal to this. So this was named one of the insights of the decade by science, one, I think the only one in physics and mathematics and engineering. And one do that. So an example of a metamaterial is negative refractive index. There are many here there is a whole lab of metamaterials. There was a workshop here a couple of years ago on metamaterials, very important subject. So let me mention two. One is negative refractive index, since it's related to what I have been talking about. We know that the index of refraction is square root of epsilon times mu. Veselago, an Ukrainian physicist, postulated in the 60s that it might be possible to have epsilon and mu to be negative, the product to be positive, and so you can take the square root with a negative sign here. And this created a lot of controversy in the physics literature. And of course, in physics, you have experiments to decide who is right or wrong. Mathematics, we have theorems you can check. So negative index of refraction is important and has applications to perfect imaging, for instance, because you can manipulate the rays in a different way. You can manipulate the rays to refract in a direction opposite to what you will expect by normal refraction. And David Smith and his group built the first negative index of refraction materials, I think around 2000, where circuits, T-shaped circuits called slit ring resonators, that work, that have negative index of refraction at microwave frequencies. So the question is, an important question is how the materials depend on frequency. So for microwave frequencies, say radar and things like that, you can have negative index of refraction. This is a simulation of what a straw would look like if water would have negative index of refraction. You have refraction in the opposite way. So that will, of course, create a lot of different effects. And the group of Chang in Berkeley built negative index of refraction for visible light. Light has a higher frequency than microwaves. That was a big development, and this is done at the nanoscale. You have to do it at a scale smaller than the wavelength. I'm not going to summarize all the work done on metamaterials. Of course, I don't have the time, but let me mention for clocking, the first experiment done was also by Smith group, and using very similar circuits, slick ring resonators, that had the epsilon and the mu, the electromagnetic parameters, approximating the ones that give you perfect clocking. So they constructed in layers. They put here a cylinder of copper, so very highly conducting, of course. And they had this effect that the waves will come in and will be deflected, like I showed you in the movie before. Of course, there has been a lot of work in trying to... This is another view, the same. This will be Harry Potter's cloak nowadays for microwave frequencies. There have been other works, and based on optics as well. This is magic carpets. You hide the object under the carpet. The transformation is just you squash this and make it look flat. This was done by Henry and G. And this has been done in practice, this metamaterial doing this magic carpets by Ergin in three dimensions. Another thing you can do is the opposite. I mentioned an analogy with black holes. Of course, we cannot do experiments with black holes, but you can use a similar idea, invisibility to trap light, to create artificial black holes. The light will come in and will be trapped here. You can do this in a laboratory. There has been a lot of work on that. This is just one of the first ones. I think they are from China. Another case that has been done and has been very successful is acoustic clocking. Actually, CT here has developed the theory, the transformation optics for acoustic clocking, the sound of silence. We want to create soundproof concerts. And this is easier to realize. The idea is exactly the same, but because the materials, this is much lower frequency. And so Chang, the different Chang et al. In Physics Review Letters, they propose materials made of plastic and holes in cleverly designed so that sound now will go around, will not penetrate here, so you will have a perfect concert hall. And perhaps the first application you will see of clocking is for sound, because the frequency is much lower. So let me finish, running out of time, but very quickly with perhaps taking a futuristic look. Another analogy with general relativity, that has been the prediction in general relativity of wormholes. This has attracted also a lot of attention in science fiction, so this is, you can have time travel, a shortcut in space-time. You can go through this tube instead of going around. The Einstein-Rose wormholes, they have not been found as far as I know. But the question is, can you do electromagnetic wormholes? So can you have an invisibility sleeve? So what you want to do is the following. You take a tube, a cylinder. This part will be completely invisible. You send light here, you know what's coming in, and you can build the material in such a way that you know what's coming out. So you can encode what's coming out. You're creating a secret connection between two different points in space. So these are ray tracing simulations. So the rays of light go around here. This part is completely invisible, this tube. You only know what's coming in, and again, you can encode what's coming out. So for instance, you can have a ray wiggling a lot. Here, you can have a ray coming back. You can have a trap ray here. This is actually what's happening with artificial black holes. This is different views of a chessboard. It depends on what you put inside this cube. The metric that you put inside is different lengths. Here you have multiple wiggling. Here you have these very nice pictures of the chess set. So what to do with a wormhole? I'm running out of time, so let me just mention one potential application. Three-dimensional video displays. You can have the cables to be invisible in this room here. You put an input and you have the output, but you don't see anything in between. You have a virtual magnetic monopole. You can put a magnetic field here and you can encode what magnetic field will come out. These two authors propose this application. Kind of a joke, of course. You have bifocals, half of the glass can see in front, and half of the glass attached to a wormhole. This is invisible, but you can see everything that's going on your back. You can see what's coming in. So you're coming in here, and but however, all of this is invisible. So the question is, I have asked a lot whether one will be able to find, to buy a Harry Potter's cloak in the store someday. Well, it's very hard to predict, especially the future. Let me mention this quote of Arthur Clarke, that any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. If Maxwell will wake up today, he will be amazed at all the developments that have come up from Maxwell equations. And I'm sure that the ideas behind cloaking, I mean, how to manipulate light and other ways, will have applications. You just have to use your imaginations. As Einstein said, imagination is more important than knowledge. So during the talk, I have made an analogy between relativity and optics. So the metric in relativity corresponds to the index of refraction. That's the way we did cloaking. So there has been a transformation from Einstein to Maxwell. So let me finish with that. Thank you. There are no questions means one of two things. Everyone understood everything, which is very unlikely, or nobody understood anything. Well, you can do the same transformation, and you can get a material that, but that's not satisfied the standard elastic symmetries. So the question is whether you can build that material or not, I don't. But in principle, you could, but however, the symmetry conditions that are required for an elastic material are not going to be satisfied. But metamaterials, a lot of the conditions are not satisfied. There have been some articles about this, about elastic waves. But there is not a good answer yet, I think.
I'm a statistician. I wonder if there is anything for us to do.
Anything what?
I'm a statistician by training. I just wonder if anything for us to do in this whole project.
I see. Well, there is in inverse problems, there is a lot of work on about, you know, when you have a, for instance, one problem in inverse problems. I don't know about cloaking so much, but for inverse problems, you have a random function that you want to recover. So you want to recover the statistical properties of the function by making measurements. So there are a lot of inverse problems like that. Also, error analysis, a lot of the measurements have errors. A lot of the time you model the errors as Gaussian distributions and things like that. But so there is how the errors affect the image is a very important problem.
In the first part, you have talking about inverse scattering.
Yes.
And then you talk about the cloaking.
Yes.
But suppose a medium is cloak, and you don't see what's inside. Can you do the inverse scattering in that case?
No, the inverse scattering will say that it's not unique. So the inverse scattering means that the observations that you make, the measurements that you make, are going to be the same as the measurements for vacuum. You will think you are seeing vacuum, but that's why the object is invisible. So mathematically, you actually prove that the scattering amplitude of measuring is exactly the same as the scattering amplitude of vacuum, zero. And so, but it's not vacuum. It's a non-uniqueness. Mathematical point of view, you have non-uniqueness for scattering.
How difficult? Because everything you're talking about is mostly in theory, right? How difficult to make something that is truly invisible?
Well, I don't know. You can answer that question.
It's very difficult.
Otherwise, you will see it now. No. This is true for any angle. The theory, is true for any angle and any polarization of light. It doesn't matter what direction you take or what polarization you take, the answer also will be the same.
I may actually respond a bit to Xiaoping's question. If all you need to do is to make things invisible in one direction, it's relatively easy. It can be very, it's no difficulty in achieving it. Even in a few finite number of directions, it's not difficult. But if you want to have an arbitrary incidence from any angle or arbitrary kind of wave, coherent, incoherent, then it becomes exponentially difficult. But maybe let me ask a question that is really philosophical. Suppose that a guy in Hong Kong got caught by the police and for stealing something. The only evidence is the video camera or a picture showing him stealing something. And he say that he want to call you as a witness in his favor and say that, Professor Uhlmann, you prove that the inverse problem is not unique. And the only evidence against him is a picture, which in a sense is an inverse problem, right? But you prove it's not unique, and therefore the evidence against him is not beyond reasonable doubt. And what would you say, sir?
Well, any image, we know this already in practice, any image that you see, you don't know whether it's a true image or not, right?
So that guy should be set free.
I'm not going to answer that. Invisibility creates a lot of ethical questions also, and not just that one. But that's something that humans have to address. Science is...
interest.
No, science can be used for good and can be used for bad. Decision of us, humans, what to do with it.
Yes.
So is it possible to use some force field to control the motion of the fountain?
Use the
force field to control.
Force field?
Yeah. Use some force to build up such a field to control the motion of the fountain.
I don't understand the questions. To find a field?
Force field. A force field. field of force to change the path of the photon.
Yes, actually, that's another proposal. There is a proposal for that, for cloaking, which is called active cloaking, to put different forces in different places, or sources, I should say, sources in different places, so that the scattering will get annihilated, will get to be zero. Well, active cloaking, the problem with active cloaking is that it's very unstable. So you move a little bit things, and then that cancellation is not going to happen. That's a good idea.
Other questions? Oh, yes.
Yes, you can do this. You can do that. Oh, moving shape.
Yeah.
You can. I didn't mention this, but you can also do time-dependent cloaking. So you can. Well, in principle, I mean, this is a theory. You can clock an event by looking at a Maxwell equation. I took the frequency case, but you can make it dependent on time. So there are proposals that have been done, and some experiments have been done to have clock an event, time and space. Using the same type of transformation is a transformation optics. So if somebody robs a bank, coming back to your example, or robs something, there won't be any camera, there won't be any record of it because it will be, the event will be clocked.
Is that true that the parameters you use to clock something depends on the frequency?
Yes.
Then if you have undependent, how are you going to?
Well, you know, it will be only true for a small interval of time. It cannot be true for all time because it will violate causality. So you cannot do this for all. For instance, for this case, talking about the time dependent, you cannot do it for all frequencies. There's one material for a frequency because it will violate causality. And the rays have to go around, and it takes the same time as a ray that goes straight through. So the group velocity will have to be faster than the case than of light. That you can, well, that is, at least with the physics we know now, it cannot be that. But however, the phase velocity can be faster than the speed of light. There's no contradiction there. So for the time dependent, it can only be done for an interval of time. So that will depend on the material that you use, how much time. The same as the frequency, how much, for which frequencies will you be able to do this, they will depend on how you build the material, how dispersive are the materials that you're building.
I just want to let people know that next Friday, CT will give a talk on similar topic, but maybe from physicist point of view. So. Oh, different topic. Oh, okay. All right.
Advertise for myself. Today's talk is about how to use material to manipulate light. Next talk, I'm going to do the reverse. I will talk about how to use light to manipulate material. So it is not.
Okay, I'm just wondering if the solution of the inverse problem is not unique, and we have an example that the cloaking.
Sorry?
I mean, if the solution of an inverse problem is not unique, sometimes it can be very wrong. Just cloaking device.
Mm-hmm.
So, what you have any to charge?
Yes, well, you know, the cloaking here has been produced for materials that cannot be found in nature. For most of the materials that are in nature, you have uniqueness. We have proven a lot of results in that direction. You take an epsilon and mu, which are positive, this epsilon and mu get to be zero at the boundary of the cloak. Then it's known, as we have proven, that this uniqueness, this problem. So for these kind of materials, special materials, there will be very special case that you will have a uniqueness. That's what you're looking for. But coming back to the practical aspects, this has been done for microwave frequencies. It has been done for optical frequencies, but not perfect clocking. I mentioned the example in science, but it's very difficult. The main difficulty is to get the mu, the magnetic permeability, to be variable, even variable. And we need the epsilon equal to the mu. That's hard to do. Otherwise, it will be easy. It would have been done by now. A lot of people are working on this, obviously. Maybe some of the work we don't know, because of course the military are very interested in talking.
Oh, are there other questions?
I was told that here, in very close to here in Shenzhen, there is an institute for metamaterials that is trying to do clocking. And the main person there is a student of David Smith, a student of David Smith, the one that I taught in. Chinese government has given him billions of RMBs to do this. I don't know how successful they are, because it's not supported by the military.
Any other questions? Let us thank Professor Uhlmann again. Thank you.